step into the spotlight. How are we doing, y'all?
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Jeez. I see everybody made their breakfast buffet at their Hilton hotels. How are y'all? Yeah, I see you. Yeah, this is the smiling face of the caffeinated nation. Well, we're going to go right into this. We're just going to let you guys know. We're going to do a PowerPoint presentation followed by a Q&A. We hope it's going to be really robust and engaging. And then we'll just stay pretty much till they kick us out. And so we're going to just go and make it work. And I'll introduce myself. Can you see my PowerPoint yet? Is my PowerPoint up?
Nope.
Hey, there it is. The Blerd panel. That's us. Who am I? My name is Hilton George. I am the BlerdCon founder and convention chair, and I'm also a self-described Blerd. Hello. Who is he? This man's name, Stan Substantial Robinson. He is award-winning rap artist, a BlerdCon music director, also a Blur. Be joining me today on the panel, working things out. Somebody knows you out there.
Hey.
So here's the plan. We're going to introduce Blerd, talk about its origin, what it means. We're going to talk a little bit about the rise of geek culture and Blerd culture. We're going to talk about the Black Nerd Experience and the larger push for diversity and inclusion. Then we're going to talk about Blerd and intersectionality, followed by the Q&A, right? So what is a Blerd? Blerd is defined as a black nerd. It got its genesis on the show Scrubs. Remember Scrubs? Scrubs was awesome. Who's your favorite character in Scrubs? Go ahead and say it. Turk. Exactly. Turk was everyone's favorite. Turk was actually in a scene where he was talking with his compatriots about a piece of technology that he was able to operate a brand new camera, where he says, I spent all weekend with my cousin. He just so happens to be the world's biggest Blerd. Cut to his white friends looking at him like, what? And then he says, a black nerd. So you get that first genesis of the word, and it starts to kind of spread out. You start to see it coming about as the Blerd culture kind of kicks in and everything like that. So we started having shows, superheroes, a rise in popularity in comics and things like that, the big screen and the small screen. And I think the biggest impact that we saw in the Blerd media experience was Luke Cage. Does anybody remember Luke Cage? Mm-hmm. Season one, where they shut down Netflix, and everybody, Netflix broke. Not the show. You couldn't access the show, but Netflix crashed. Okay, so it was like really, really crazy because everyone was wondering what was going to happen with this black character in like blaxploitation style in Harlem. I mean, his operating headquarters, his lair was a barbershop with two old guys playing chess. I mean, you just don't get any blacker than that, right? He's seducing women with coffee. I mean, come on, y'all, right? And everybody wanted a piece of international, every race, every gender, you know, all over the world. So you see this marketability being demonstrated in stark contrast to all of the stereotypes and everything. And I think if we didn't have Luke Cage and the success of Luke Cage the way it happened, we wouldn't have gotten the Black Panther movie that we got. You know, that doubling down on saying, well, you know what? Maybe we don't need a white savior in Africa, for once. Maybe we could have a black director, a black screenwriter, black costume designer, black, you know, I mean, they really, really doubled and tripled down on the blackness of this movie because it's like, well, how many millions and millions of dollars did Luke Cage generate? I think that there's a market for it. So I think that the audience and I think that the studios recognized and they put that out there. And the way that we got it was just this amazing, amazing movie. And then there's other shows that followed, obviously. Black Lightning, I think it was a little bit more in the black style, kind of like Luke Cage. Yeah. It's kind of got that, you know, that savior of the neighborhood, you know, type of a thing, but with more of a Family Cosby twist to it.
Yeah, one major link between all three of the things we discussed, I think, is the soundtracks for all, because like
music.
With our culture, that's a major part of all of it. That like it's the perfect way to kind of bring everything together, you know?
It's like the glue that creates the feeling. Like we don't know how to feel when we're watching TV shows or movies until we hear the soundtrack. You know, what was this experiment they did where they showed the end scene of Star Wars, the awards ceremony? It's like supposed to be one of those big dramatic scenes, and then they took the music out, and it sounds ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, it's hard to watch. It's hard to watch.
You guys remember the controversy around Starfire? Mm. Did anybody actually get to see the show Titans? I know it was on that one specific streaming service. Let me tell you something. Anna Diop did amazing as Starfire. Despite all of the criticisms and things like that, mm-hmm. she was badass. She had, you know, real lines, a real story arc. And I think she shut down a lot of critics. But then again, you're also seeing this as another example of studios banking on diversity as a way of storytelling in the nerd sphere. So the black nerd experience, okay. We all know that being a nerd comes with an exclusionary experience. You know we're gonna be separate from everybody else, right? You all remember this. That was we know where we were in this picture. We know, right? You don't have to say anything. She needs a hug. She's like, oh my God, yeah, middle school, they got me, right? But I think the only difference that really separates black nerd experience from traditional nerd experience is that not only did we have to turn in our cool card, but we also had to turn in our black card. Mm. Like, so what would happen is that what we did in the, you know, if you were into Dungeons and Dragons or comic books or anime or video games or RPGs or whatever, those things were considered to be not just uncool, but unblack. So not only could you come out with your tray, remember when you come out the cafeteria with your tray and you had to look for somewhere to sit? Like, there was nobody wanted you to sit. You had to kind of use your tray as a little barometer, like you're looking for water in the 1800s. You know, you're kind of trying to figure out, oh, I got a signal and I got to go sit down. You didn't have that. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we're trying to do and one of the things that we're already seeing happen is changing the image of the black nerd. You know, we all remember Steve Urkel, right? Mm-hmm. Now, that's a corny outfit. We laugh for generations at Steve Urkel. And then you go and watch, like, the NBA Finals and watch these guys getting off the bus, and they're wearing Urkel gear. They got the glasses.
Right.
They got the suspenders. They got the extra medium shirt on, you know, shoes hiked up, pants hiked up, mm-hmm. you know. And that's stuff that we were wearing back in the day. Like, dang, this is cool now? Like, what is going on? It's high fashion?
Right.
Like, what is happening?
Right. It's high fashion.
Right. Like, right. It's expensive stuff. Like, Izod mm-hmm. shirts, you can't buy in a pack no more. You got to, right. like, that's, oh, I got to take this polo off the hanger. Excuse me. Right.
Right.
Well, see, now you see a more smoothed out image of the black nerd. You know, you got Key and Peele. You got Donald Glover mm-hmm. with Kamau Bell. Right. You know, and you're seeing this smooth out, and you're seeing more of a refined look of the black nerd. And it's important that when we start talking about the black nerd, it's not just about being black and nerd, because we're not all just one thing, right? Right? I'm black and I'm a nerd, but I am seven or eight other things, just like everybody in this room.
Right.
So this is a very important graphic. Oh, am I on? Oh, there we go. So this is a very important graphic you see here. And you know it's important because it moves. And this is a good point for any of you. It's got all of the different aspects by which we define ourselves. You know, it could be our age, physical ability, gender, ethnicity, sexual orientation. All of those things come into the black nerd and. And so we try to figure out ways in which we can both cater to ourselves as black nerds while still being welcoming to those other aspects of us that we bring with us into the black nerd space. Does that make sense? Okay. But then you always have the debate. Do we have to be black nerds? Why can't we just be nerds like everybody else, right? And there's this idea that for some reason we're all just this one big nerd fraternity. Like we all are just hanging out in the same places and stuff like that. And to the large degree we are, right? But the thing is that, you know, with the unique experience that we have and the special levels of exclusion that we experience, you know, our community is starting to connect within the larger nerd community in ways that we hadn't seen before, right? So you see more characters that are, you know, more positive. So you've got Moon Girl, who by canon is the most intelligent person in the Marvel Universe. This is a black girl, not too much older than that one back there, with the same hair and everything, right? And I'm sure you're just as smart. You know, she's helping me with my taxes earlier. She's very good. And then you see the reflection of that character in cosplay. You know, a black woman, a young black woman embodying and emboldening herself in this character that is positive and powerful and strong. Then you see characters like Ironheart. This is a character who takes over the mantle for Tony Stark, you know, brilliant engineer, a heroic heroine, you know, who goes in and takes on a mantle and is saving lives and you know, operating at class 100 like anybody else. And then you also see us. This is how we interact with our fandom, right? This is how we do it. And you see cosplay, and you see us buying comic books and imaging, and I think that there's a connection between how we see ourselves in our sphere and how we end up manifesting ourselves in real life.
Absolutely.
So this is the same girl who was doing the cosplays, a salutatorian at her high school, going off to UVA on a full scholarship. So I think the idea that we are creating this blurred space for all of us existing blurs is important, but these next generation are now looking to this space for inspiration, for guidance, for impression, for inspiration, and we have a responsibility for that. So diversity, inclusion, and representation. This is the question that we have to ask ourselves. How can we support the mission, right? You know, we cosplay, you know, we get our Black Panther cosplays and our gear and stuff, and we come out, we do meetups, you know, we buy certain comics, we support artists, you know, we come out into the marketplace and we see vendors that are Black-owned businesses in the geek sphere, and we try to get out there and support them. And another question is, will studios produce more POC-centric and movie shows and characters, and will Black and brown writers, directors be allowed to tell the POC stories? You know, at some point, you know, we are one bad sequel away from losing all of this, okay? If Black Panther 2 does not do exactly to the nickel what Black Panther 1 did, it's gonna be a whole other Black Panther 3, we don't know. We don't know what the next show is gonna be. So this is like an ongoing thing because we've seen this before. And will the POC community show up and show out? Remember when Black Panther came out, we all got our dashikis and ordered, went on AliExpress and eBay and got our authentic stuff, and we were standing in line, looked like the opening scenes from Coming to America, man. It was beautiful.
I did a dashiki a day for like a week, at least a week strong. Look, probably 9 days.
On LinkedIn, talk about Wakanda forever.
Right, forever.
My LinkedIn page.
Right.
So I think what happens is that we have seen this before. You know, we have seen these gains being made as a society, as a culture, as a community, and then we see all the success coming up, and then we have doubts. You know, we have concerns, we're skeptical, you don't know, right? So going into that skepticism, we have a convention called BlerdCon. Now, the thesis behind BlerdCon is to, one, invite guests from underrepresented communities, find talented and accomplished and under-recognized community members to come and participate. We also want to reach out, encourage people to submit panels. You know, there's not a lot of people out there who have ever done a panel or have ever done a workshop or feel like that their story is worthy of the dais. Right. So we can go up to interesting people we know in our community and say, oh, this would be an amazing panel. And they're just like, oh, I can never do that. Like, that's something way over there. We have to kind of cultivate that. We have to encourage that. And then also we have to try to create a space for blurreds and blurred intersectionals to gather. And what I think we accomplished, and you know, as music director, this guy, when you come to BlerdCon this year, how you feel at BlerdCon is going to be largely because of what the work this man has done, because the music, like he was saying, the soundtrack.
No pressure
is going to be amazing. So what we want to do is, have any of you guys seen the BlerdCon video? Okay, we got 1, 2, 3. Okay, we're going to show it. Now, it's going to be in like panoramic, you know, IMAX for the first time. Mm. So we want you guys to take a look at it. And then, you know, we'll talk about, you know, what we can do this next year and what we can do maybe as a community to kind of cultivate and build out and grow and see if we could do more stuff like this.
Everybody will be dancing, and we're feeling it right. Everybody will be dancing, and we're doing it right. Everybody will be dancing, and we're feeling it right. Everybody will be dancing. stars rule the night away. Oh yeah.
So in conclusion, the diversity is in the fandom. We're here. I mean, you go to pretty much any large-scale convention, you see every race, you see black people, you see people of different genders, gender identity, orientation. We're in the building, right? The real question is that with the growth of conventions, you know, with the expansion of geek culture, you know, are we going to be able to insert ourselves and assert ourselves in this space? You know, BlerdCon is a microcosm. That is like a little home base, you know. Then the question is, can we then bring that out in that community, follow us to all the other nerd spaces that we go to that maybe aren't specifically made for us, right? So that's the cool opportunity that we have, because we have to take steps to be the representation that we seek. If you say you don't see enough panels on certain subject matter, then you've got to put one together, gather some folks, and submit them, right? If you say that there are certain guests that you'd like to see at conventions that are more representative, you know, you got to hit those convention runners up and say, hey, have you guys thought about this? You got to thought about that. You know, we have to try to assert ourselves even outside of the spaces that are built for us. Because if not you, who? If not now, when? Right? So that's our presentation. All right.
Well, I just want to add real quick. And so as somebody who's went from, I guess, just being a fan and participant at BlerdCon to now being officially being a part of the family, I was kind of like distant cousin, you know what I mean, and then worked my way in. But one of the things I love about the work that that we're doing, I remember, I think it was a local news channel, they actually came to cover BlerdCon. And an elder was there with her child. And one of the things she said, man, and every time I watch, you can look it up on YouTube, but she basically just said how worried she was about her child finding his place in the world, I guess. You know, like trying to find his people. And so when she went to the con and she looked around and saw how many different people, you see your child, right, and these different people. You see your siblings and all of your other family amongst this group. And she was just saying how she was happy that her son finally found his people, right, like his group, like where he belonged. As a father too, I bring my family to almost every con that I go to. And one of the things that makes our con a bit different, I call it, and I've said this to him a bunch of times, I was like, it's like the Black family reunion with cosplay, right? I love describing it like that because that's how it feels. And I love a lot of the cons we go to, it's a great experience, but there is something unique about what we've, about what this brother and the rest of the team has managed to put together and that now I'm a part of. And I think it's more than needed. And you just see things that I haven't seen other places. One of my favorite cosplay was the brother who was, we had a Sikh, a brother who's a Sikh as Captain America. That imagery, right? Like Captain America as a Sikh, right? Like just, it was, and then the Iron Merman brother, because we just don't highlight it. Yeah, he's here too. So the brother who he's, confined to a wheelchair, but he dresses as Iron Man. But then when his chair stands up, he has a fin. So he calls himself the Iron Merman. And he's a war veteran, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so just the different folks that we've managed to highlight, not just because of their ethnicity, but also other things that make them unique, like from veterans to the brother and his disability. It's a special experience. And so we're just trying to do our part to push and lift up our community. It's one of those things. It's the importance of valuing ourselves and lifting up those around us. So. Yeah.
Don't let this brother downplay his role. he's been working with BlerdCon since day one. From just being helpful on the sidelines, like, hey man, I got this artist. Hey, we can come perform, mm-hmm. and all that sort of stuff. So he's been there from day one, and I think there's a lot of people who are contributing because mm-hmm. it is a community. We talk about BlerdCon, and since we're specifically talking about BlerdCon, it really is about not just building a convention. But building a community. There's a lot of us who've never connected with people that look like us in the nerd space. Now, I was at the Schomburg up in Harlem, and I had to make a statement to him. It's like, look, you guys are in Harlem at the Black Comic Book Festival. Here, blackness is kind of, I don't want to say easy, but it's accessible in ways that it's not in other places. Like you could live a life supporting black businesses and seeing like-minded people of color every day if you live in and around a community like Harlem.
Sure.
But there's black people in Ames, Iowa, and both of them are very, very good people. I'm telling you, I've met them. But they have a harder time building communities in different parts of the country, right?
Sure.
So with a convention like this, you've got people who are used to blurred spaces, and then you got people who have never seen more than four black nerds in a room before, who walk in and just like, holy crap, like, look, it's just an ocean, might be 50. It's an ocean of blackness. Right. Like, where are you from? Like, Sanford, North Carolina. Okay, I got you. Right. I see where you're coming from now, right? So anyway, we could talk all day, and we do, about the nerd space, the blurred space, BlerdCon. We'd like to take questions from you guys. If you guys have any questions, if you have anything you want to, put to us or share with the group, the microphones are right here at the podium. Now, they're recording this, so that's why we want you to if you have a question, get up and go to the mic. But, the dialogue that we have when we're at events like MomoCon, the community that we're able to recreate when we're outside of the blurred space, I think is just as important as what we do inside BlurCon. And shouts out to MomoCon because I have, you have a convention that the organizers and the runners who have known about and have worked with and supported BlurCon before BlurCon year one. When I met the organizers, they were like, oh, we really love what you're doing. We really want to support it. If there's anything we can do. And the con runners, the chairs, the committee, like any one of them have made themselves readily available to myself and my committee for anything we've needed. And it's helped us avoid some of the common potholes that first year and second year cons often run into. And when people come to the con and they say, oh my God, this is a first year con, or oh my God, this is a second year con, I'm like, yeah, I've run this whole program by, like, people have been doing this for 20 and 30 years, and they're like, no, that's gonna be a problem. Oh, you wanna put something here, whatever, whatever. And you start to see, even at MomoCon this year on the guest list, you notice this guest list a little browner than you might have expected from you? You see some, yeah, right? Yeah, you see Estelle, you see the Iron Merman, Ron Seaman. You see the cosplayers. We even Cutie Pie Sensei is a cosplay guest. Now, they've always done a good job bringing in probably more.
Quick plug. In fact, tonight is the Bites and Beats concert with Shingo, too, as the headliner. But myself, Asheru, the brother who did the opening song from the Boondocks, will be performing, and the NPC Collective. So that's another great example of what we're
talking tonight,
about.
That's tonight, right? Yeah, absolutely. You're seeing 11. The intersection of hip hop. Is that 11?
Yes.
At 11, where?
That's a great question.
All right.
Right.
Good.
I will get back to you on that part. Right. Sorry.
We put it to the people. Right. We'll have it where you want to have it. We're going to bring it right here. At
right.
11 o'clock.
Right.
11
here,
a.m.
Right.
We're going to do it.
No. There you go.
But yes, keep an eye out for that, because it's funny how much of the soundtrack of hip hop and anime and geekdom is in their shows that you didn't even plug in. Like, you're like,
sure.
Oh snap, like that was them, like, oh my God, like, you know, like, we jam, like, remember when the Boondocks used to come on every single time? You were jamming to that song, like, that's my jam.
Oh,
dun, 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 right. Like, that piano track kicks in, you know what I'm talking about. And that's that intersection of nerddom and music and nerddom and blackness, you know, because that was a really black show. Like, you am I right?
Black,
like, that's probably
black. Blue,
I
black.
Mean, one of the blackest TV shows to go on broadcast network. I mean, here's the thing. Boondocks was too black for BET.
Right.
I mean, am I right?
Yeah.
Because when the Chinese
super
bought
facts.
It, they
super
said, oh, no.
Yeah.
No.
Super facts.
Like,
yeah.
And irreverent. Like, oh, the CEO of the network that we're being broadcast on, here's an episode for you. Like, oh, my God, are you serious? So, I mean, we really, really, really had a voice in places that we didn't even know we had it. So for here at Momo, you know, we have an opportunity, and I think it's also because Momo's being held in a chocolate city. You know, you can't have 30,000 nerds gather in a city like Atlanta and not have us there. That's, you know, come on, right? This is Atlanta, it's a chocolate city. Now, D.C. is also a chocolate city. It's just kind of got a marshmallow center.
Yeah.
It's kind of chocolate, you know, around his, you know what I mean? You know.
Yeah. Yeah.
He gets
round two.
He lives.
I was assistant director of prevention services for Covenant House. That's a mouthful. And when I was in D.C., I was at the meeting where they were like, so newsflash, you know, this is 2007, where they said when the city really started to change, right? Like, as Obama started running, and that's when DC started becoming like a hip city. And so, yeah, it's slowly changed a lot. There's been a lot of gentrification, but don't get it twisted. Like, you know, we just had, what's it, Mochella is what they called it, where they were trying to get rid of go-go, like,
oh,
loud music,
man.
And they just brought, like, go-go bands, like, right out front of the property. Like, we just going, Mochella, that's what we call it, because we call everybody Mo. So, yeah, that part, separate conversation. I probably went too far. I'm sorry. Carry on.
But, yeah, you come to a town like D.C.
Yes.
There's a soul to it.
Absolutely.
There's a heart.
Pocket.
So it's easier for us to do a BlerdCon in, say, a D.C. Other than maybe some other city.
Sure.
So if you're coming from an area that is outside, you're going to see some people who are from, I mean, you're like maybe 4 hours from New York. The North Carolina, Virginia area is within a 5-6 hour driving radius. So we've got this regional, you know, patchwork of people that come in, even within the black community. And, you know, the other thing is that people talk about inclusion and diversity. And we also talk about, you know, inclusiveness. And, you know, you saw in the video, we had people of every race. And in the previous year's video, you saw people of every race. And I said, oh, can we have a black space without 100% black people? And I say, yes, that is my hypothesis is yes. And if you think about it this way, if you think about a BlerdCon specifically, you think about it like a really, really, really awesome, hip, new soul food restaurant, right? Black-owned soul food restaurant. And everybody loves soul food. I don't care who you are.
Right.
You may not eat it every day because of wherever you live or who your family are, whatever, whatever. But everybody likes fried chicken. Everybody likes pork chops. Everybody likes greens. You know, I mean, those are all universal things. The difference is that when we have it, we are the ones on the menu. Mm. You know, we are the ones who are kind of leading the charge. And the intersectional pieces of it are something that everybody can connect to. And so somebody who's coming from, like I said, like Ames, Iowa, who might have friends or partners or even family who are from other racial, ethnic backgrounds, should be able to come and enjoy the convention just like anyone else, but still have this opportunity to learn and this opportunity to consume and this opportunity to connect. And going back to music, music is the universal connector. You know, I mean, everybody doesn't love anime, and everybody doesn't play video games, and everybody doesn't cosplay, and everybody doesn't read comic books. You know, we do have our little tribes within the nerd community, mm-hmm. but everybody loves music.
Absolutely.
Right? You show me somebody that doesn't love music, and I'll show you a bad person.
Evildoer.
You are a bad human being if you don't like music. I don't care what kind of music you do like. If you just don't like music in general, there's something wrong with you. You're gonna kill a lot of people.
Stand back.
Before it's all over, right?
Right.
So with those things in mind, you know, we come in and we still manage to have, you know, we're about maybe 95% African American, I think, in the attendance. Mm-hmm. But we were able to get like the Sikh Captain America.
Yeah, that was amazing.
Was a big feature. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you had, we had the Latino, mm-hmm. the Latinx community coming. Because we're not all, you know, we got Afro-Latina people, mm-hmm. right? And we got Blasians. And, you know, the funny thing about black people is that we embrace any part of blackness you have.
The one drop rule.
You got right. If your mom is Vietnamese and your dad is black, you could come to the cookout. Isn't no, come on. Like, you know, you just got your hair might be a little different, your eyes, but you know, you look at me. Yeah, you probably might be darker than me. Mm-hmm. Come on in. You're part of the community. So when we expand that out, you'll find that those intersections make our community a lot larger than we sometimes think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our advocates and allies are places that we don't always know that they are. And let's not get it twisted. We're in D.C., but we're technically in Virginia. We are on the other side of the river, mm-hmm. right? And so we are in Arlington, Virginia. Now, you can see, like, Reagan National Airport and all of D.C. from the building. That's how close we are to D.C. But it is Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, how will we be accepted in what is technically a red state, you know, in a much more white part of the region, right? And...
Yeah,
it's purple.
It's purple, man. Yeah.
Now you're talking about, they even got a purple line going through, right? Because
mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's all in the community, right? We have a, go get on to that mic, girl. Talk
Please.
To us. Share. I love this cosplay,
clearly
by
we
the
can
way.
Talk. Yeah.
Yes.
Hello.
Oh,
is that you?
Yeah, hi.
Hey, I can't, the lights are in my face.
Yeah. I work in MakeCon. I'm a little nervous.
It's okay.
I work at MakeCon phase a lot, so I go to a lot of conventions, and as soon as I heard that BlerdCon had a MakeCon phase, I knew that I had to stop what I was doing and be a part of something that, you know, is greater than myself, and finding ways to, like, connect myself also to the community. So I have two questions.
Awesome.
NPC collective idea, and I wanted to know more about the NPC collective, if that's something that is a national thing, because when I looked on the website, it said there's like the South Side, East Side. I was like, oh, we got sides, so if there's one that's like somewhere here in Atlanta, I'd love to just step on in and see what I can do.
Okay.
My second question has to do with the website connection thought. I have a lot of Facebook people of color, Blerd Facebook pages, and they're all over the place, and I'm like a part of like four. I was wondering if there is any way that, I don't know, someone could start like connecting us
Ultron.
In some kind of way.
Right.
Because I really would like to go to these meetups and things like that, but I don't
right.
know where to go, so if there's gotcha. Any way you could direct me, that'd be great.
Sure.
You should start with MPC.
Yeah, yeah. So with the MPC Collective, I would highly suggest, like, come out tonight, meet some of the guys and stuff. I believe Chris Allen is the founder, or at least co-founder, of the MPC Collective. And so basically, for people who don't know what the MPC Collective is, it's a Nerdy People of Color collective. And it's a collective of different musicians, nerdcore artists, or artists who have somehow, whether they're doing video game themed music influenced highly by anime, different pieces of nerd culture. So like artists like Samus, so on and so forth. This is more for the people who don't know, right? And so basically it's a collection of artists spread out around the country, and most of the folks do not live in the same state, right? So like I'm based in the DMV area, that's DC, Maryland, Virginia, for those who don't know. Chris Allen is in Orlando, Florida. Mega Rands in Phoenix, so on and so forth. So usually what happens, cons is what pretty much brings us together. So like Samus and I will be at BlurCon, right? And Mega Rand and a lot of the collective was at MAGFest earlier this year. So, but yeah, it's just a network of artists who work together to pretty much help further along each other's careers, create opportunities for each other in spaces that sometimes, you know, because hip hop's a dirty word sometimes in certain spaces. Now, hip hop's the highest grossing music in the world, right? But the reality of it is the term hip hop in itself, people usually think it comes with a negative connotation. So this idea that you can have musicians who aren't making, you know, negative music per se, maybe a little bit of language in there, but it's not negative, right? Artists who are well-educated, you know, someone like Samus, like I don't know how many degrees Samus has at this point, but she's a rapper, right? But she's working on her, was it her doctorate right now, or PhD, right?
Fellowship,
yeah, she's amazing. Like the definition of black excellence, definition of excellence, period, right? And so, It's a group of artists who celebrate that, who are creating opportunities for each other in different spaces. And so definitely, I would highly recommend that you come out tonight or catch us at our booth. I can introduce you to Chris Allen. That's definitely something we could talk about. And we're always just looking to build with more like-minded artists and create opportunity and spaces for those artists. And I'm new, like, to it, you know? I just kind of got indoctrinated this past year, like, into the collective, right? Like, I don't even think I'm on the website yet, you know what I'm saying? it was just something I talked to Chris Allen about, and he created an opportunity where he just wanted, because I love cons where I was just going just because my nephew, I introduced him to anime, and he was like, Uncle Stan, we should go to some cons. I'm like, what's a con? Right? Because I'm a guy who grew up, I'm sorry if I'm long-winded. I'm a guy who grew up in a community where it was not acceptable to be a nerd, right? And that's pretty much the case for a lot of us, right? But I always, my boy used to call us like cool nerds. Like we were the guys who had to kind of walk that line because it could mean like physical harm, like, right? You know, like, so we had to carry a certain edge just to keep ourselves safe in the areas we lived in. But at the same time, I was into comic books. I was into all of these different things. I was into anime, you know, before my boy was making music for anime and we were doing these, right? And now that it's more acceptable now than it's ever been. So it's almost like we can wear our hearts on our sleeves without having to worry about, being beat up, being bullied, and these things still happen. But understand, you know, I'm 40, so understand where I came from and the things I saw, and truthfully, the things I participated in as a youth. It's come a long way since then, and so I don't turn a blind eye to that. And so I'm glad that we have these spaces, and I'm glad we're doing these things to allow people to embrace it even more and be proud of it and not be embarrassed of it. So we love to talk to you more about it later.
Well, I think that this is the way you described it is a perfect segue into your question about all these different online black and brown and POC nerd communities coming together as a unified force. I don't know if that's necessary for them to no longer be the individuals and kind of be a part of some larger federation. I think that they're very different. They're fluid. You know, you have somebody that'll start a POC cosplayers and then have to move on with life and then bequeath it to someone else who then takes it in their direction. And so it kind of has its own organic a way of connecting. What I would recommend, and this is for you people out there in the world too, if you want to do meetups, work through the convention. Mm-hmm. So if, like, let's say Atlanta Area Cosplayers, which is a group of cosplayers obviously based here in Atlanta, comes out and says, hey, we want to do a meetup here in MomoCon. Where can we have it? Can we have it as a part of the official or the official social media, stuff like that? Then, you know, they'll come in and say, sure, and then it'll be on all the promo, it'll be everywhere, and then you won't have to have just subscribed to that one group in order to know about the meetup.
Yeah.
So it's a, it's something that we, it's the kind of information we can share so that we know what's happening and kind of how we can connect. And I was actually talking with the team about doing more engagement type activities, you know, being able to go out and say, well, let's do a meetup or a meeting or a hangout at a local bar or a restaurant or at some part of the con venue where we're like maybe take an hour or 2 hours where we're just going to all come together and just hang out, drink, party, whatever it is we're going to do depending on the venue, and do that at more conventions as opposed to just doing panels or just doing tables and that sort of thing. Right. So, yeah, that's something to pass along. If you are members of groups and you know that they're doing something, tell them, hey, I see you got this meetup scheduled for this con I'm going to. If you talk to the organizers and maybe see if you can get it on their official social media or their official event, online event or something like that, that'd be a great way for us to connect.
Thank you.
Thank
really
you.
Good to see you again.
Shout out to the Prince glasses, by the way. You know what I mean? Super fan of Prince. Sorry.
Sorry. My name's Kalinda, and my question is BlerdCon going to be, or a variation of BlerdCon, going to come down to Georgia or the Atlanta area?
We're here. What are you talking about?
I mean, yeah,
we're here. Well, like, we're not even here. Like, right. It won't move. We may do certain activities outside of our region, and it will depend on, you know, what is going on. Like, I think it's much easier to piggyback off of things that are already happening, like MomoCon and DragonCon, Anime Weekend, Atlanta, that kind of stuff, where we might do, like, meetups or special activities. Mm-hmm. But moving a convention, like, across country is, it's like, yeah, it's a really, really heavy thing. And that's why you don't see it very often. You know, that Wizard World model is a different type of a business model from the community-based conventions. So I wouldn't wait to see BlerdCon come to Atlanta or anything like that. But we will be here. The presence will hopefully be felt even if we don't bring the entire con.
Okay. And even if, like, BlerdCon wasn't coming to Georgia, would you still help with, like, set up? Like, let's say Atlanta wanted to make their own version of it. With MomoCon, so like we want our own name and you guys want to team up with us. Would you guys also be interested in helping build that up as well?
Well, actually, I've had several groups that have reached out at new conventions that I have either worked with, like actually sat down and helped, you know, work with the infrastructure, or just been an advisor. I think that's part of giving back. Mm-hmm. It was never, the intention of BlerdCon was never to be the only convention like it is. You know, the idea of BlerdCon was to create a moment of both fan and financial viability so that if somebody on the West Coast or somebody in the Deep South or somebody way up north wanted to do a POC-centric, nerd-centric event like a BlerdCon in their area, then maybe, you know, they could at least hit me up for advice or get some templates or just, you know, help getting started. Because MomoCon helped us, DragonCon helped us, Otakon helped us. You know, there are so many conventions out there that have helped us come to where we are. Then we've got to pay it forward. And absolutely, anybody who's doing something like this, we definitely would want to help.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
The Mars Red Prince has arrived. I had to get you, man. I had to get you.
So, curiosity question. When I was in Chicago this year, seen Ron DMC, with hip hop being such a huge part of comic book culture and in general, has BlerdCon ever thought about doing like a touring concert?
It's trying to kill me. Right. Just for the record, most of us, and I'm just speaking for everyone I know, most of us are pirates. We have a day job, and we do this with whatever time we can carve sure. out of our traditional 9-to-5s or not. And we may get to a point where this is something that we can do in full time, but not right now.
Right. Right.
But a traveling show with more of a blurred centric look would probably fall onto this man's plate more than myself
right.
as a music director. So I'll
yeah, sure. So knows. Yeah, I definitely see the possibility of that in BlerdCon's in our future as BlerdCon. I know right now with the MPC Collective, part of what we've been doing is bringing these Bites and Beats concerts to different conventions around the country. And so a lot of times the challenge is, because again, you know, whenever you mention hip hop, it turns certain people off. But the reality of it is, you know, whether folks accept it or not, it plays a major role in certain shows that is very much a part of this culture, very much a part of nerd culture. So we've found different ways to market it to folks so that they see the connection. And more importantly, we have direct connections to these artists literally around the world. So what we've been managing to do, and so this year we're bringing it to MomoCon. You're gonna see some of the artists at BlerdCon. We're doing probably the biggest concert at Otakon this year, where it's a Nujabes tribute show. So Nujabes, for those who don't know, if you watch Samurai Champloo, was the gentleman who produced a good amount of the music for the show. But even though it was a Japanese show and with mostly Japanese artists, one of the producers on the show, music producers on the show, was Fat John, who was a huge inspiration to Nujabes, and he happened to be a black artist. And so we're doing this tribute show at Otakon, celebrating this Japanese music producer who worked in anime. But a good amount, majority of the artists that he collaborated with were black. And so so it makes the concert look a bit different than what people are accustomed to seeing at conventions, but the reality of it is it's still connected. It's just not the connection that some are used to seeing. And so, so we're definitely working very hard to bring it to more conventions. We're in talks with a convention in New York right now, also Anime Expo in LA, and several other cons. And, you know, and me and this guy has a meeting that he doesn't know about that is in my agenda right now about a really big show for next year. Not this year's con, but for next year. So, you know, it's making its rounds, and we're definitely going to figure out how BlerdCon can be more involved with that. But it's difficult right now trying to grow that and grow BlerdCon and then find a way for it to work seamlessly, you know? So we're figuring that out right now, because it's a lot of moving parts.
And I will tell you, just to your point, this is how real the hip-hop connotation is that he's discussing. Mm-hmm. So we have the outdoor food truck rally,
yes.
right? Mm-hmm. There was an insurance company that I was trying to work, because you got to do insurance. You go through the things that describe what it is. Now they're asking, are you going to have, like, rides?
Pretend this is tea.
You know, all of this stuff. And, and one of the stipulations, it says you cannot play. Now, to be fair, they said rock music, heavy metal, mm-hmm. and all that, but also rap music. If you mm-hmm. play this at your outdoor event, your insurance would be nullified. And it's like, this is like all the music you pretty much covered, except for, like, the JCPenney elevator Muzak.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's about all we could play and not cross. Because even, I mean, the musical genres mm-hmm. have crossed so much.
Absolutely.
And blended so much that you almost can't tell the difference between hip-hop and R&B and now country. I mean,
right.
come on, people.
Right.
Right?
It's blending.
So it's getting a little bit of everywhere. So I do understand that there is an audience for, you know, this type of hip hop and, you know, nerd music and black nerd experience and things like that. But, you know, I think the idea of piggybacking off of existing conventions where we're already at is probably where you would see more of the tour of concerts that you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to maybe like this, just a free floating
sure.
Event that kind of comes around.
Cause you guys are going to, if I'm saying it wrong, correct me, QuirkCon? Quirktastic?
Yes, I will be there. You going to Quirk?
We'll talk about it.
Well, I'll be at QuirkCon in Durham in a couple of weeks, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Next week, right?
Is it next week?
It's next week.
I'll see what my then bus ticket says, there. And I will be right.
There. I want to be there. Then I guess
I'm going to QuirkCon.
Right. There it is.
Yes,
right.
Yes, but we know about QuirkCon. We'll definitely be there, and so you should get on. We already talked about this. Get your ticket. Just go. Or he said nobody got to go with him, so whatever. Going on, sir. What do you need? This will be our last question, time, right? I believe.
Yeah, so being that STEMs-related industries kind of go hand-in-hand with nerd culture, me being working in that industry for so long, we still have a diversity issue. Like, seeing us is, like, few and far between. So what I've been seeing at some cons to kind of just get people interested in that is, like, intro to coding or learn how to solder, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Is there any, future intention of bringing that aspect to like the programming of Blerd?
Mm-hmm. And in all fairness, me and this man know each other and we talk about this quite frequently, so I think I say he knows the answer to the question, but he wants you to know the answer to the question, is, you know, we are partnering with groups like NSBE, the National Society of Black Engineers, which ironically is headquartered like 3 miles from the BlerdCon headquarters in Arlington, Virginia. So, you know, I'm already in touch with them to try to get more, because there's, in D.C. is a very, very big tech hub. Mm-hmm. And you got NASA and Raytheon and NSA and the Pentagon and everything like that. So trying to make that connection, as you saw in the slides, that connection between nerd culture and STEM is very close. They are actually the cultural component of one another. Mm-hmm. And you'll go to a robotics competition and you'll see half the people in cosplay. You know, if you go to a coding, a coding event, you'll see people wearing anime shirts and stuff. Sure. It does not look that much different than this. I have been to robotics competitions in this building, and aside from maybe a stray wig or two or a prop, it looks exactly the same amongst the young people. So the bridge between STEM and nerd is very narrow. But I think that conventions like us and MomoCon and others are very uniquely positioned to make that connection. Mm-hmm. And anything that we can do to kind of add that cultural component to education would be a big plus. Unfortunately, right now there are no pre-existing programs or mechanisms that are existing in the government side or the tech sector that would readily insert into this place. So it's up to us to try to create that very narrow bridge where a NSBE guy can come in and do some coding, or we get some robotics and stuff, and let people know that there is a world of living that you can have with your nerd experience. You know, you can be a geek in your academics as well as in your style and your fashion, as well as in your music and everything else. So we try to make all those connections. We are right at the top of our hour, so we're gonna have to close out in a couple of seconds. I want to thank everybody for coming out and showing love to the panel. We know we were early and we're on day one, so there's a lot of people just getting here. And listen, all you guys that just arrived, we're counting you in our attendance. So you will.
Thanks for
you
making
will
us
get,
look
You will
cool.
get an email.
Can I walk the line of? I'm gonna say something. It's funny though. I promise you, it's funny. I just think it's awesome that at a BlerdCon panel that like a large group of white people came late. I just think that's so funny. I think that's awesome.
Okay, yes.
I'm sorry. I got pushed the envelope a little bit, but I just love y'all for that. Thank you. See how much we have in common? You see? I'm sorry. Did I go too far? I'm sorry. Okay.
Well, I think you, sir, were right on point.
Thank you.
On that note, we will end. Thank you guys for coming out.
And before Chris
I
Allen
go,
just walked through the door, by the
before,
way, so I'll
before
introduce
Before we go,
you.
I want to remind you, the BlerdCon booth is in the back rear section. You go to the left and the back of the vendor hall. We got a DJ. We are hanging out. We are partying. Please come on by. Take a picture. We might take your picture. Mm-hmm. You can get a little video. It's a safe space for bad dancing.
Yes.
Please feel free
by
to
all
mess
means.
Up, mess up your favorite dances.
Do it for the gram.
Hang out. We're having a lot of fun. And so we'll love to see you guys there. So see y'all later.
All right.
I couldn't resist.
That was brilliant.
The wheels were turning, you know?
That was a good one, sir. That was worth the pennies of gold we paid to get in here.
Good, man. How you doing?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Thank you so much, man.
You know, I think the lyrics are where the line might be, but they didn't really say it. What's up, man? I heard you had a show coming up. Somebody told me you had a show coming up. How you been, man? I haven't seen you since. God, it's almost been like